This is TWiT.
I already voted, so you can't influence me, Cory. What do you think? I know you're a Canadian. You don't have to worry about this stuff.
Well, there's two different parts to it, and I'd be interested in what you're more interested in. The first is like the pluses and minuses of 24, which, like you, I've had a lot of people ask me about. And then the other one is this idea of whether putting prices on data will solve the data issue. But
right.
I mean, I can answer
question.
Either or both, but yeah. You tell me what you're more interested
well,
in.
You know, the controversy over 24, well, one of the things the reason McTaggart came back to the proposition, and we have, it's kind of a broken system in California that really comes from a legislature that prefers to stand back and let democracy take control. It's fairly easy to get these propositions on the ballot. You only need to collect a small number of signatures, which you can easily done if you've got the money to do it. So we get all sorts of kind of oddball, conflicting propositions, but even kind of disingenuously worded propositions. So poor voters in California, and this might be true in other states now, have really got a challenge ahead of them to read these, to understand what they do. We have a very good California Consumer Privacy Act, but it did apparently cut out, you know, some carve-outs for some companies. On the other hand, people have complained that Facebook had a hand in writing this ballot proposition. So this was their way of saying, we're protecting you. It's impossible. It's really impossible for the average person to figure this out. Given the amount of time we have and the number of propositions we have to vote on, I often wonder if this is a system that's got any hope.
But which would you like to know about? Would you like my views on 24?
Yeah, start with 24. Start with 24. We'll get to NRUP next. All right.
So 24, the history of this is that the first time around CCPA was passed. It was passed in somewhat in haste. It had a few defects.
They were really trying to get the initial proposition off the ballot 2 years ago.
Sure. That's right. And then what I think from its backers' perspective was more disturbing was that it then became the target of just an endless slew of reform bills that would have made it worse, not better, that were heavily financially backed. And I think that they were dismayed at the thought that they were just going to have to spend the rest of their lives babysitting this bill and staving off this kind of attack. And so the ballot initiative, the new one, creates a requirement that the bill not be amended except in furtherance of its purpose, which on its face sounds like a good way to avoid that kind of skirmishing. But I've been in the middle of people who I respect who are really ferociously disagreeing with each other about this, who are normally on the same side.
That's what I suspected.
So I have been taking these arguments, right? The person who tells me, well, you know, the furtherance of the original purpose solves that problem, to people who are skeptical of it. And they say, well, except that the way the bill is worded is it says to promote the competitiveness of Californians and the privacy of Californian people and the growth of California's economy and fundamental equities.
So everything fits the purpose.
So like, what is in the purpose, right?
Right.
Well, I mean, there are lots of bad faith answers to that. But the question is, how much time do you want to spend litigating it?
Right.
So rather than spending all your time in Sacramento lobbying over it, you might spend all your time in the Ninth Circuit litigating over it. And it's like, it's six of one, half dozen the other. And the idea that you make legislation that is bulletproof and that no one can come along and amend.
That's just a bad idea on the face of it.
It's a lovely idea if you support the legislation's
yes.
ends, but it's not.
It seems a recipe for disaster.
It's wishful thinking.
Yeah.
Right. And so I think that 24 makes some compromises that I wouldn't make. In particular, there's two things that I'm concerned about. The first is that it doesn't have a private right of action. And that means that if your rights are violated, you have to convince like an attorney general to bring a case on your behalf. And the thinking was that there was no way the California Chamber of Commerce and other big business lobbies would allow this to pass unless the private right of action were stripped from it. Because once there's a private right of action, they're worried about so-called nuisance suits. I think that that's a pretty grave defect. And then the other grave defect for me is the – sorry, I just blew my buffer on what the other grave defect is. That's the big one.
It should tell you something that the people against Prop 24 include not only the Republican Party, but the Green Party, the Libertarian Party, the co-founder of the United Farm Workers, Dolores Huerta, the ACLU, the League of Women Voters. They don't want it. But then,
so I don't want to say, I don't want to counsel you to vote against it because I am thoroughly on the fence about it.
I know.
And I remember what the other thing was, which is that it, there was the thinking of the backers is that if it had a default to privacy where you had to opt in to have your data collected instead of opting out to not have your data collected, that this wouldn't pass First Amendment muster. And there are some First Amendment litigators I know who say that's wrong. And there are people with a good track record of litigating difficult tech-related First Amendment questions. And so I'm not a lawyer, I'm not a First Amendment lawyer, and I'm not a litigator. And so I'm left with these people. Normally the way that I resolve these issues is like you. I find a technical expert and I who I trust and I ask them for their judgment. And generally the pool of technical experts I rely on agree in the main. And this is an area where they're very split.
Right.
And I'm, you know, it's one of the few times I'm thankful I don't get a vote.
That's why I asked you, Cory.
I understand.
And you have not helped me.
I had a local candidate for our city council ask me this morning how he should vote.
I just want you to know, I supported your candidate for the Texas Railroad Commission.
Good. She's amazing.
I sent her some money.
Me too.
This, Amy, in case you weren't familiar with this, I can't remember. I think you might have mentioned this, or maybe I read something that you wrote.
T. Boone Pickens' old lawyer.
Yeah. T. Boone Pickens' lawyer? That's who she is?
Yeah.
That's funny because, weirdly, in Texas, it's the Railroad Commission that decides whether oil wells can burn off the natural gas. You've seen it all the time in movies, these flares coming off of the oil wells, which, of course, is a huge pollutant, a major contributor to greenhouse gases. And it's the Railroad Commission that decides whether you can do that or not. And she could turn the entire Texas Railroad Commission on its ear and stop this practice of flaring.
They would basically have Texas's emissions. And the commission is structured so that it requires consensus to grant a permit. So one person can block it. It's a three-person commission.
Amazing.
It's this amazing race. Yeah,
I'll be watching that race. You wouldn't think I'd be watching the Texas Railroad Commission race come November 3rd. But
so I'm interested in what Amy has to say about Prop 24.
Yeah, so, and you're not a voter in California, Amy.
No.
But, and probably haven't been following it that closely. The reason it's important is as California goes, so goes the nation. It's a big enough economy that if California has these strong privacy laws, just as GDPR really influenced everybody in the world, it would very much influence United States companies, especially those who operate in California. So it's of importance not just to those of us in California, but to everybody.
Yeah, but I guess I would put that within the context of what does the House and Senate look like and who's in power over the next, you know,
the federal government.
Well, here's why. We continue to have these. Listen, or maybe we should just make up our minds.
You can't do it state by state. You're saying you need a federal law.
All I can tell you is Amazon has a wristband out called the Halo, which listens to you all the time. And, you know, it's not quite a Fitbit. It's not quite an Apple Watch. This does some of the same things, but it also scrapes your biometric data to make inferences like, are you feeling hopeful right now?
Right.
And are you exhausted? Things like that. You know, there's ambient noise that gets picked up on the other side.
Yeah, you're wearing a microphone all the time. When you say, hey, a word, but all the time. Other hand, it works so poorly. I've talked to people who've used it.
It doesn't matter. The use that doesn't matter to me. That doesn't matter. What matters to me is how do we manage consent in a multi-state system where we've got state by state laws that differ?
Yeah, but Amazon's never going to make something that you can't sell in California.
Right. So what you're saying is that if this passes in California, then every other state's privacy goes in the same direction. I don't think that's the case.
I think it would impact companies that would like to sell a product if they know that just as California's California's emissions laws affected the world.
It did. But even GDPR is managed differently country by country in the EU, and the enforcement, and that's really what I just whacked myself on the face with my own microphone. The real question comes down to enforcement. And GDPR is enforced differently within countries, within parts of countries where you've got different local agents interpreting things differently.
Okay. So, by the way, I just tricked you guys.
Okay.
Because we've said all along, there's a solution. There's a solution. There's a legislative solution. There's a governmental solution. Here is a possible solution, and neither one of you can agree on whether that's a good idea or not. I don't understand how we can even hope for a government.
I want to hear Amy's other solution.
Okay, what's your other solution?
So a couple of years ago, I'm always trying to think through, like, I understand what the problems are. How do we, like, what's the most clever solution?
So that's rarely, by the way, the calculus. It's usually more, politically? What can we get through? What can we write an ad for? So what the most clever one is often the one that gets passed by.
Right, the cool thing everybody wants to talk about, all the government leaders are talking about data ownership as though that makes sense. But what would it take for there to be data ownership? Anyhow, so here's what I have been mulling. What I've been mulling is, for a while, the state of Alaska, if you live in Alaska and if you are a resident, I think you have to have been born there. Norway does something similar. You get sort of a basic universal basic income dividend check from oil. And my thinking was, we have a social safety net in the United States that's going to collapse. And that was true pre-COVID. And we have long-term medical that the medical needs of people who are aging are not going to be met. Also true before COVID. So is there some way that we can solve some of those problems while also solving the problems of data? And where I came back to was, if it's the case that all of our PIIs are at this point increasingly being consolidated by just a few companies, wouldn't there be a way to consolidate, not all of them, but a lot of them, such that they were anonymized, but available and permissions could be given as needed.